Okay.
This time I'm going to be showing you how the franchise all began. Well, technically, the beginning of a different Snake's origin. And the first Metal Gear game that I've ever played, Metal Gear Solid 3. Oh, European Extreme. Oh. I'll just go normal. The other thing that I don't like about this is that I need to keep playing it daily. Otherwise, the food will spoil.
After the end of World War II, the world was split into two, East and West. This marked the beginning of the era of the Cold War.
Damn, I was just about to voice it too. Konami presents. Hideo Kojima game. By David, well, voiced by David Hayter. Suzette Minette, Lori Alan, the level voices. Jim Ward, USA! Ryan Cummings, James Mathis, Heather Haley, Jim Pittock. Fox. 5:30 a.m., August 24, 1964, Pakistani
Approaching Soviet airspace. 20 minutes to drop off. Commencing internal depressurization. Equipment check. Arming parachute.
All right. You ready to go?
Okay.
Good. We've got high visibility.
Cigar.
Put out that cigar. Connecting oxygen hose to interior connector. Put on your mask. Does this panty waist know what he's doing?
Approaching release point.
10 minutes to drop off.
Hey, are you deaf?
He said, put out the cigar and put on your mask.
And he throws the shit. Typical smoker.
Depressurization complete.
Checking oxygen supply.
6 minutes to drop off. Opening rear hatch.
Ah, bright light. Gotta get a solid snake eater.
External temperature -46 degrees Celsius. 2 minutes to drop off. Stand up.
Yep, take a cigar.
Stand by. Status okay, all green.
Prepare for drop off. Countdown 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Spread your wings
and fly. God be with you.
Whee!
Jack, I've got some important news. The head of the CIA has finally given us the green light for the virtuous mission.
Virtuous mission?
No, the virtuous mission. The future of our Fox unit depends on it. If it succeeds, we'll be officially organized into a unit.
Virtuous mission?
Sounds like some kind of initiation ritual.
You know, don't get cocky. This isn't a training op.
Right. So what exactly is this wonderful mission?
Well, about 2 years ago, a certain Soviet scientist requested asylum in the West through one of our moles. His name is Nikolai Stepanovich Sokolov. He's head of the OKB-754 Design Bureau, one of the Soviet's top secret weapon research facilities, and the East's foremost expert on weapons development.
Sokolov, isn't he that famous rocket scientist?
The very same. On April the 12th, 1961...
Soviets achieved the first manned space flight in history.
The Earth was blue, but there was no God.
Well spoken. The rocket that carried Yuri Gagarin to orbit was the A-1, known as the Vostok rocket. Sokolov is said to be the man most responsible for the multi-engine cluster used in that rocket. After Gagarin's flight, Sokolov left rocket development to become the head of the newly established Design Bureau.
From a lowly technician to head of a design bureau, that's quite a success story. So why do you want to defect?
It seems he'd become afraid of his own creations.
Afraid?
We call it a crisis of conscience.
And for that, he left his country and his family behind and went over the fence?
Not exactly. One of his conditions was that his family was also to be taken safely to the West. He used a mole to get the family out first and succeeded in sneaking Sokolov over the Berlin Wall shortly afterwards. I was the one who conducted the operation.
The security on the eastern side was still full of holes back then. Then what?
We got Sokolov over in one piece, but the whole ordeal had left him exhausted. And we checked him into a hospital in West Berlin. It took him 2 weeks and more than 600 miles to get from the research facility in the Soviet Union to Berlin. He was in no condition to say anything coherent.
Oh, wow.
And it was only a week later that we had something much bigger on our hands.
The Cuban Missile Crisis.
October 16, 1962. President Kennedy received word that the Soviets were in the process of deploying intermediate-range ballistic missiles in Cuba. The president demanded that the Soviets dismantle and remove the missiles. At the same time, he announced a naval blockade to prevent further missile shipments from reaching Cuba. But the Soviets didn't back down, instead placing their armed forces on secondary alert. Soviet transport ships carrying missiles continued on course towards Cuba. U.S. and Soviet forces went on alert for an all-out nuclear war. Frantic negotiations were conducted through the U.N.'s Emergency Security Council and unofficial channels to end the hair-trigger standoff. Finally, on October 28th, the Soviet Union agreed to remove its missiles from Cuba. And so the world avoided a nuclear holocaust. But in order to get the Soviets to pull their missiles out, we had to make a deal.
You mean the one where the U.S. agreed to remove its IRBMs from Turkey?
No. The Jupiter IRBMs deployed in Turkey were obsolete. And we were going to get rid of them anyway. They had no strategic value whatsoever to either the U.S. or the Russians. The Turkey deal was a ruse, a cover story that was fed to the other intelligence agencies around the world.
So what did the Russians really want?
Sokolov. They wanted us to return Sokolov.
You mean the Soviets pulled out of Cuba just to get their hands on Sokolov?
That's right.
Oh, wow.
What the hell was he working on?
At the time, we had no idea. We were running out of time. It's either give up Sokolov or risk full-scale nuclear war. In the end, we had no choice. President Kennedy gave in to Khrushchev's demand. The next day, I got Sokolov out of the hospital, handed him over to agents on the eastern side. Sokolov kept on screaming, "Save me," until he disappeared from my sight. Then a month ago, we received some new information from one of our moles.
About Sokolov?
Yes. He was taken back to the research facility and forced to continue working on the weapon in question under KGB supervision.
Oh, man.
What's more, it's on the verge of completion.
So what kind of weapon is it? Something to do with space rockets?
No. Missile.
Same technology.
I guess you're right. We don't know the details, but it appears to be a new kind of nuclear device. For half a year now, the Soviets have been conducting frequent nuclear tests at semi-palatinate.
Something to do with the weapon, I assume.
We're talking about a secret weapon so big that Khrushchev was ready to pull out of Cuba to get it back.
Is Sokolov still in the facility?
No. According to our intelligence, he's in Salino Yat, a place in the mountains about 3 miles to the west that's known as the Virgin Cliffs.
The Virgin Cliffs.
Nice name for a virtuous mission.
They moved him there just recently.
Why?
Apparently, they're conducting a field test of the weapon, but it's our best chance to get him back. This mission would never have been possible if he was still in the research facility. This is our last chance. Sokolov must have known that, too, when he contacted us.
I'm still free falling.
Listen up, Jack. Your mission is to infiltrate Silly.
Shit. Remote fell asleep.
Ensure the safety of Sokolov and bring him back to the west.
Woo!
If we don't get Sokolov back before that weapon is complete, we'll be facing a major crisis. The clock is ticking. Once we've confirmed the rescue of Sokolov, stand by at the recovery point. A recovery balloon will be dropped at that point. Helium will be pumped into the balloon to inflate it. The process takes about 20 minutes. Once it's complete, the gunship's arm will latch onto the balloon and pull it up.
The Fulton surface-to-air recovery system. I'm familiar with the theory.
Take it easy. It's been combat proof.
Major Zero.
Sokolov is up to it.
The shock will be less than during a parachute jump, and the arm can handle up to 500 pounds.
So you're planning on going over the border in a single combat talon?
She's equipped with 2 6-barrel 20mm Vulcan cannons, as well as 2 40mm machine guns.
Sounds like she could hold her own against a battalion of tanks.
Even with the fuel in the reserve tank, we're facing a 4-hour time limit. If all goes well, it shouldn't take more than a few hours.
Home in time for dinner.
But if anything goes wrong, you'll be eating dinner, breakfast, and all the rest of your meals in the jungle.
Damn it. Shit. My backpack. Sure, just start taking off all that shit. Dramatic unreveal. Snake, David Hayter. Zoom.
Listening in. From here on out, we'll be using code names to refer to each other. Your code name for this mission will be Naked Snake. I'll be referring to you as Snake from now on. You're not to mention your real name.
Snake?
What, you don't like snakes?
What do you mean?
You've eaten one before, haven't you?
In survival training.
I'm glad to hear that.
I don't know if I'd ever order one at a restaurant, but...
Be careful. You might not have a choice.
What about you, Major? What should I call you? you.
Hmm. Let's see. I'll be Tom. Call me Major.
Major Tom.
This will be a sneaking mission. You must not be seen by the enemy. You must leave no trace of your presence. Is that clear? This kind of infiltration is the Fox unit's specialty. In other words, weapons and equipment to procure on site. That goes for food as well. You're completely naked, just as your name implies.
Great. Now I see why you asked me if I like snakes. I suppose calling me Snake was your idea of a joke, too.
No. There's a good reason for that. I'll tell you later when the time is right.
Gotcha. Getting back to the subject, how exactly am I supposed
to
feed
myself? Male, 55, UK. Extra English. Board smell.
Medical supplies in your backpack.
Yeah, about the backpack. I lost it in a tree on the way down.
I see. Well, you better go back and get it then. You know where it is?
No problem. I can see it from here. It's stuck on a branch.
To climb a tree, stand in front of a tree that's covered in ivy and press the action button. I'll be monitoring your progress over the radio. We can't risk violating Soviet airspace, but I'll be in the gunship. My frequency is 140.85. I'll give you a call if I need to talk to you. If you need to talk to me, use the send function. Okay, Snake, go get your backpack.
Oh, man. It's been ages since I played this. Wait, stand up. Go here. Let's go this way. Alright. Got it.
I see you've retrieved your backpack, Snake. To equip a weapon, it's necessary to take it out of your backpack. In the survival viewer, choose weapon from the backpack. Your available weapons will be displayed in a window in the upper left. From that list, choose the weapon you want to equip and press the enter button. For other equipped items, just do the same thing from item.
Got it. Use the survival viewer backpack.
Yep, that's right. Survival is fundamental to this mission. Mm-hmm. After you've been out in the field for a while, your stamina will start to drop. If your stamina gets too low, it'll affect your performance. You won't be able to shoot accurately, for example, and your wounds won't heal as smoothly. Keep an eye on your stamina so you don't run out. To recover lost stamina, you can hunt for local flora and fauna. You can use either your tranquilizer gun or your knife to hunt.
My only weapon is a Mark 22 Hush Puppy tranquilizer gun?
That's right. It's been fitted with its own suppressor. However, the suppressor will deteriorate every time you fire. Once its durability reaches zero, the noise suppression effect will be gone. So don't get too trigger happy with it. The suppressor's durability is shown in the item.
Mm-hmm.
Any weapons and equipment beyond what you're carrying now, you'll have to find as you go.
I have to find my own weapons and equipment. Whose crazy idea was this anyway?
Solo covert actions are standard Fox operating procedure. You can't leave any traces of your presence. No weapons, equipment, footprints, sweat, or bodily waste. The same goes for bullets and cartridges, too. Your presence in enemy territory is already a violation of international conventions of warfare. There aren't supposed to be any American soldiers in Russia. It could spark an international incident. You can't let anyone see you. You can't let the enemy know you're there. This is a stealth mission.
Mm-hmm.
You're a ghost, Snake, in every sense of the word. And there'll be no rescue if you're captured. The military and U.S. government will deny any involvement in the affair.
Then I'll just have to take care of myself, huh?
I'm afraid so. You've been given a fake death pill for that purpose. SIS guidelines stipulate that soldiers on covert ops like this one be issued a potassium cyanide capsule. Tape it to your body so you can take it when you need to.
How generous of you.
Well, damn.
Use it if you're taken prisoner by the enemy. It will send you into a state of false death for a short time.
Fooling them into thinking that I'm really dead. So, how do I come back to life?
Just take the revival pill.
You mean that thing they put in my tooth before the mission?
That's the one. But be careful. If you remain in a state of false death for too long, nothing will be able to bring you back. Remember that.
I'll keep it in mind. You said this was a solo mission, right?
Right.
I guess that means I can't count on any reinforcements.
Correct. The mission rests entirely in your hands.
A real one-man army.
Relax. There's a support team ready to back you up over the radio.
Ooh.
I'll introduce them to you. This time, survival is of utmost importance. The first member of the support team will be in charge of monitoring your physical condition, acting as a medic, so to speak, as well as recording your mission data. She's a member of Fox as well, and she's here on the gunship with me.
She?
Hello, Snake. I'm paramedic.
Paramedic.
As in a medic who comes in by parachute.
Aren't you going to tell me your real name?
Are you going to tell me yours?
She's 28, USA.
It's John Doe.
1936, Boston, Massachusetts.
You're a regular Captain Nemo.
A name means nothing on the battlefield. After a week, no one has a name. What's your name?
Jane Doe.
Ha! Funny.
I wasn't joking, but I'll tell you my name only if you manage to make it back alive. My frequency is 145.73.
She's also in charge of recording your mission data. Whenever you want to save, send a message over the reserved save frequency, 140.96.
So saving lets me record my mission data.
That's right. It also records the state of your health.
Good to know.
There's one more person I want to introduce you to, Snake.
Huh?
Speaking of snakes, you remember the boss, don't you? A legendary soldier and your mentor. Actually, it was the boss that got the DCI's authorization in the first place. She's going to be serving as Fox's mission advisor.
The boss is?
She also helped me plan this mission. She and I were at SAS together.
Jack, is that you? How many years is it then?
The boss. The boss?
That's right. It's me. Talk to me. Let me hear your voice.
It's been 5 years, 72 days, and 18 hours.
You've lost weight.
You can tell just by the sound of my voice.
Damn.
Of course I can. I know all about you.
Really? Well, I don't know anything about you.
What's that supposed to mean?
Goddamn.
Why'd you disappear on me all of a sudden?
I was on a top secret mission. You didn't need me anymore.
But there were still so many things I wanted you to teach me.
No, I taught you everything you needed to know about fighting techniques. I taught you all I could. The rest you needed to learn on your own.
Techniques, sure. But what about how to think like a soldier?
How to think like a soldier? I can't teach you that. A soldier needs to be strong in spirit, body, and technique. And the only thing you can learn from someone else is technique. In fact, technique doesn't even matter. What's most important is spirit.
Good
spirit
point.
And body are like two sides of a single coin. They're the same thing.
Sure.
I can't teach you how to think. You'll just have to figure it out for yourself. Listen to me, Jack. Just because soldiers are on the same side right now doesn't mean they always will be.
Mm.
Having personal feelings about your comrades is one of the worst sins you can commit. Politics determine who you face on the battlefield.
Good point.
And politics are a living thing. They change along with the times.
Oh, yeah.
Yesterday's good might be tomorrow's evil.
Is that why you abandoned me?
No, it had nothing to do with you. I already told you, Jack, I was on a top secret mission. A soldier has to follow whatever orders he's given. It's not his place to question why. But you're looking for a reason to fight. You're a natural born fighter, but you're not quite a soldier. A soldier is a political tool, nothing more. That's doubly true if he's a career soldier. Right and wrong have no place in his mission. He has no enemies and no friends. Only the mission. You follow the orders you're given. That's what being a soldier is.
I do whatever I have to get the job done. I don't think about politics.
That's not the same thing. Sooner or later, your conscience is going to bother you. In the end, you have to choose whether you're going to live as a soldier or just another man with a gun. There's a saying in the Orient, loyalty to the end. Do you know what it means?
Nope.
Being patriotic.
It means devoting yourself to your country.
I follow the president and the top brass. I'm ready to die for them if necessary.
The president and the top brass won't be there forever. Once their terms are up, others will take their place.
I follow the will of the leader, no matter who's in charge.
People aren't the ones who dictate the missions.
Then who does?
The times. People's values change over time, and so do the leaders of a country.
Oh, shit.
So there's no such thing as an enemy in absolute terms. The enemies we fight are only enemies in relative terms, constantly changing with the times.
As long as we have
loyalty to the end, there's no point in believing in anything, even in those we love.
And that's the way a soldier's supposed to think.
The only thing we can believe in with absolute certainty is the mission, Jack.
All right, but do me a favor.
What is it?
Call me Snake.
Snake? Oh, right. Your code name is Snake.
Ah, shit. Running out of time.
That's right. The legendary unit that the boss put together during World War II was a snake. The Cobra unit.